Nel demo di video is parallel plate capacitor with dielectric material part 3. In part 3, we want to formally solve the problem that so far we tackled using simple tools. So qualitative understanding of the problem. Now we want to quantitatively solve it by means of the Laplace's equation with boundary condition. So the method of Laplace equation and boundary condition. This is for boundary conditions in this case. So how do we proceed? Well, I remind you that we have four interfaces, A, B, C, within which there is the dielectric material, and D. What is the solution of Laplace's equation in vacuum or in an ILH dielectric material? Well, obviously, we know that in this case we choose this to be our x-axis of a Cartesian coordinate system. We know that Laplace's equation is fulfilled also inside the ILH dielectric material. So, regardless of whether we are in vacuum or in the ILH dielectric material, Laplace's equation is valid. And so again, the scalar Laplacian of B, for symmetry reason, only function of x, same reasons why E is uniform, has to be equal to zero. With respect to this Cartesian coordinate system, this simply means that the second derivative with respect to x two times of B of x has to be equal to zero. We have seen this equation several times in FIS 242. What is the solution to this equation? The solution is Vx equal alpha x plus beta. Very simple in this case. In this problem, however, we have three regions. We have region one, we have region two, and we have region three. So we can solve Laplace's equation in each of these regions. And so in particular, we are going to solve it in such a way that, so Vx, we write it as alpha k x with an index k plus beta k. And k can be equal to 1, 2, or 3. So this k selects the region we are looking at. So if we are in region 1, we are in vacuum. In region 2, we are in the dielectric material. And in region 3, we are in vacuum again. So this is the general solution. And now what we want to do is to find alpha and beta 1, 2, 3. So six parameters. That's what we need to find. Two for each region. So how do we proceed? Well, when we start here on the left-hand side, clearly the equation we need to use is Coulomb's theorem. Why is that? Because A is the wall of a conductor in MEE. So we need to use Coulomb's theorem. So if we use Coulomb's theorem at A from 242, remember that the area of this plate A is this funny A, okay? Not to be confused with this A, which indicates the plate itself, the interface. And so in this case, from Coulomb's theorem, we know that minus, because we are doing Coulomb's theorem not for the electric field, but the potential is minus gradient of V, so it's minus the integral on what on the surface capital sigma associated with A, and what the skin of this surface, which is infinitesimally close to it, C242, so is sigma A plus. So we are looking at this surface somewhere close to it here. This is sigma A plus. And again, I urge you to look at 242 for all the details of these definitions, which I extensively use in 242. Okay, so from this, what does it tell us Coulomb's theorem? Well, it tells us that we need to perform the gradient, which in this case is the directional derivative of V. And so in what region are we? We are in region one, to use Coulomb's theorem. And so we need to perform the directional derivative, which, since we are only, v is only a function of x, is the derivative with respect to x of which v, v1, so let's put also an index k here. So it's v1 of x. And this has to be integrated in dA. It has to be integrated in dA in this fashion. Okay. What is the result of this integral? Well, beta is a constant, so it cancels out. We are deriving with respect to x, so we are left with alpha, k equal 1, so alpha 1. So the result of this integral, remember that the sigma I plus means to perform first the derivative and then the limit, but now we got rid of x, so this limit basically doesn't is not useful anymore. We don't have to perform it anymore. It's just because it's a simple function, okay, just function of x linearly. So we are left with minus alpha in region 1. Since this is a constant, we just obtain from the integral the area A, the total area of that plate. Now this quantity here has to be equal to the charge on that surface divided by epsilon naught. And so it has to be equal to the total charge, which is plus sigma F, is positive charge, plate A, times the area A divided by epsilon naught. So as always, A and A cancel out. And so from this, we obtain finally that alpha 1, the first of the six parameters we intend to find, is minus sigma F divided by epsilon naught, which makes sense because obviously we are in vacuum, so we are dividing just by epsilon naught in this case. So this is the first of the six parameters we want to find, parameter one. What about the other parameter, which is beta one? Beta one, well, we know that this conductor on the left-hand side of A is in macroscopic electrostatic equilibrium. That is, the potential is constant throughout the entire conductor all the way to the surface, which is an equipotential surface. Because of that, the potential V, 1 at 0, which is right at this point here, has to be equal to a constant, which is in fact beta 1, and this we can call it VA. It's something which we can tune up. In principle, it could be 0. Let's just set it to VA, an arbitrary constant value. It's all equipotential. So this is the second parameter we intended to find, and again, it's correct because we are in MEE, in the region here on the left-hand side. Okay, so now we found two of the six parameters, four to go. Now the most interesting part. So how do we proceed next? So this was the calculation for region one. And now we want to proceed with the calculation in region two. How do we find the parameters for region two, that is alpha two and beta two? Well, a few videos ago, we introduced the concept of multiple dielectric materials and the boundary conditions for the potential, which have to be fulfilled in order to obtain parameters. And so how do we proceed? Well, we know that the derivative, the so-called Neumann condition, which I didn't call it as such, but it's called the Neumann condition, I'm telling you now. So it tells us that the epsilon of a certain region times the derivative of the potential in that region with respect to variables in the limit going to the boundary of that region, on the other side of the boundary, it has to be equal to the epsilon that other region times the derivative of the potential in that region. So this is very complicated words in real life. What this means is that in the limit, so remember that this is a naught, so for x which goes to L naught minus, that is I'm approaching from zero the boundary B from the left, so L naught minus of, in this region we have vacuum, therefore epsilon naught of the derivative with respect to x of V1x. Note that it's always worth starting with this Neumann condition. This Neumann is dealing with derivative. Why that is useful? Because we get rid of the betas. You see, Coulomb's theorem also gets rid of the betas. This Neumann condition also gets rid of the betas. That's why it's beautiful, because we get rid of one constant. So this allows us to find alphas. Okay. So this, what is the result of this calculation? Well, obviously we know what is our V1. We know that is alpha 1 is minus sigma F over epsilon naught times X. So we need to derive this quantity, so alpha 1, I put it here, beta 1 goes away, so derived with respect to x, I'm left with this parameter times epsilon naught. Okay, so the result of this is minus sigma f over epsilon naught times epsilon naught, so it's minus sigma f. This quantity has to be the same as the limit, the other side of Neumann condition, for x that goes to L naught, but from the plus side, that is, I'm approaching B from the right-hand side. There, the potential rules in the region is V2, but we are in epsilon D. So now we have epsilon D there, which is the permittivity of the ILH. It's not epsilon naught anymore. And again, the derivative with respect to x of V2 of x. And so what is the result of this calculation? Well, beta 2 cancels out, and so I'm left with alpha 2. X also goes away from the derivative, so it's alpha 2 times epsilon d. And so from this condition, we can finally find our parameter, the third parameter, which we intended to find, which is alpha 2. So alpha 2 is given by minus sigma over epsilon d. Minus sigma f over epsilon d. Okay, so this is our parameter number 3. What about beta 2? This is a little bit more complicated. So beta 2, calculation-wise. So for beta 2, we proceed as follows. So the limit for x that goes to Lz minus, this is the Dirichlet condition, Neumann derivatives. Now Dirichlet is continuity of the potential. And so in the continuity of the potential case, we know that the potential on the left and on the right has to be continuous. And so we need to do B1 of x. So the result of this calculation is going to give us minus sigma f divided by epsilon naught, which is our alpha 1, times x, but x is in the limit L naught, plus VA, which is beta 1. And so this quantity has to be equal to, let me separate here, not to make confusion between these two parts. So in this case, this has to be equal to the limit on the other side, which is the limit for x that goes to L0 plus of what V in that region. So we are again in region 2, so we need to do V2 of x, which we know has to give us minus sigma f divided by epsilon d times L naught plus beta 2. So this is the quantity which we want to eventually compute, this beta 2. And so what is the result for beta 2? Well, for beta 2, we obtain let's write it down here. So for beta 2, you should do it. It's actually quite simple to remember for me what it is, the result, without doing all the math, which, you know, is putting together all these epsilon naught and epsilon d's. So beta 2 somehow takes into account the fact that we have a screening polarization here at B, which is negative. So it is, if you do the calculation, you can do the algebra, but actually simple, is VA, and then we have this, the partial screening, which is minus epsilon RD, which is the relative permittivity associated with epsilon D, minus 1, which we found previously in a couple of different ways, divided by epsilon RD. This is partial screening of what? Of sigma f, so this is the whole partial screening, times L naught divided by epsilon naught, because we are in the region where the left-hand side is the vacuum. Okay, so it's VA, and then there is this partial screening, and then there is L naught over epsilon naught. So that's, if you do the math, that's what you find out for beta 2. And so that is our parameter number 4. Now, what about the last part of our calculation. We want to go into region 3. So if we go in region 3, we want to compute alpha 3 and beta 3. The procedure is exactly the same as the one outlined here. And so how do we proceed? Well, I will just write down again all these limits. They are exactly the same. The only difference is that in this case, we have the limit in the Neumann condition for x that goes. This is the boundary, which is at the distance from the origin, which is a naught plus LD minus of epsilon. What epsilon? In this case, we are inside the dielectric, so epsilon D. Derivative with respect to x of V in the dielectric in the middle, we have V2 of x. This quantity, which I will not compute, has to be equal to the limit for x that goes to L naught plus LD plus of epsilon naught, because we go back in vacuum, of derivative with respect to x of B in the second vacuum region, we have B3. Okay, and so the result of this limit eventually give us the parameter alpha 3, which is the fifth parameter, which is similar. We are back in vacuum, so it has to be the same as the first parameter. It's minus sigma F divided by epsilon naught. And if you do this math, which I urge you to do in Piazza, you will find out that that's the result of this limit, Neumann condition. So Neumann again allows me to find alpha. What about the last calculation we need to perform, which is to find beta 3, or in that case, Dirichlet condition. So the limit for x, which goes to L naught plus LD minus of V2 in the dielectric material of x, has to be equal to the limit for x that goes to L naught plus LD plus of which one? B3, where is the last parameter we still need to find, which is beta 3. If we do that, again, we find from partial screening, but the opposite way, that beta 3, clearly we are looking at the interface where we have a positive charge. So remember that here we have an accumulation of positive charges, and whereas here we had an accumulation of negative charges. See the part one of this video for more details on that, on the qualitative understanding. But in this case, we're going to get as a result is similar to this, but the screening is positive. So we have VA plus epsilon RD minus 1 divided by epsilon RD times sigma F, so partial screening, but with the opposite sign. And now, of course, we have LD divided by in the case, in the last parameter, we have LD divided by epsilon naught. LD divided by epsilon naught is what we find here. And again, it's plus epsilon RD minus 1 over epsilon RD, which is exactly the opposite of the screening. So again, to be noted that here we have a negative screening, here we have a positive screening, and the only difference is here we have D, whereas here we have L naught. Okay? Okay, so again, if you do the algebra, you will find exactly the same, this result, which I just gave you here. So please do so again in Piazza. So now what I ask you to do in Piazza is to show in detail all this calculation here, please, from which I gave you the results. So with this, we have all the six parameters. So this parameter number 5, this parameter number 6. So we have the Laplace equation, well, the result of the Laplace equation, which is alpha k x plus beta k for all the three regions, which are all connected by means of these conditions I wrote down here on the board. And the other question I have for you in Piazza is, what is the relationship between, let's say, the potential V1 at zero compared to, for example, the potential V3 at L? So what is the relationship? Is this bigger, smaller than V3? And how do you prove it, given all the constants which you found here? You should convince yourself what happens to the potential. And so to recap this video, now finally, we wanted to find a more formal solution to the problem of the parametric capacitor with dielectric material. And so in this case, we use Laplace's equation with boundary conditions. So there are three regions, so three solutions to a very simple Laplace equation, because it's all symmetric, because the symmetry is simple. We have three equations with two parameters, so a total of six parameters what we need to find. On the left-hand side, we start always with the conductor, where we have, of course, in a conductor, Coulomb's theorem. Coulomb's theorem allows us to get rid of beta because it's a derivative. It involves a derivative with a minus sign. So we find alpha, alpha 1, which is minus sigma for epsilon naught. In ME, this conductor, of course, has an equipotential block, and so we can set the potential to be VA or 0 if you want. When we go to the second region, at this boundary, we need to impose Neumann condition, the continuity of these derivatives of the potential with the proper epsilons, though. And if you do that, you find alpha 2, and the continuity of the potential, the electric potential itself, from which we find always the beta coefficients, in this case beta 2, where we assume there is some partial screening happening here with a negative sign on B. Similarly, you again impose the continuity with the proper epsilons of the derivatives of the potential, Neumann, as well as the continuity of the potential, which allows us to find respectively alpha 3 and beta 3. All these six parameters. You plug them in here and you find three equations, which now eventually in the next video we're going to plot. Another thing you can do in Piazza is to use Coulomb's theorem with respect to this coordinate system, to this Cartesian coordinate system, to verify that what I found in the beginning of the video, that is that alpha 1 is minus sigma f over epsilon naught, is correct. And how you do that? You basically want to verify that sigma at d is equal to minus sigma f. And so I let you think how, using Coulomb's theorem, you can show that sigma at d, it's minus sigma f, which has to be for a parallel capacitor, because that's the way we set it up. But I want you to show that the detail, which is quite important, because again, it allows you to use again one more time Coulomb's theorem. There are always problems with Coulomb's theorem. That's it.